I am Dr. Vinita Bhadauria, Associate Professor of English in Government College, Behror. Welcome in this video on The Sea and the Skylark by G.M. Hopkins. In the previous video on G.M. Hopkins and The Sea and the Skylark, I have given you a brief introduction of Gerard Manley Hopkins and the poem written by him, The Sea and the Skylark. It is written in the form of sonnet with iambic pentameter. It is a 14-line poem. And he adopts the sonnet pattern of Italian writer Petrarch, who is the father of sonnet. In this video, I am going to explain the poem to you. The poem is consisted with one octave and one sestet. Octave is 8 lines and it is divided into 2 quatrains. And the last 6 lines are sestet and these are divided into 2 tercets, 3 line stanza each. So, we will begin with first stanza. On ear and ear, two noises too old to end. Trench right, the tide that ramps against the shore, with a flood or a fall, low lull off or all roar, frequenting there while moon shall veer the wind. These are the opening lines of G.H. Hopkins' sonnet entitled The Sea and the Skylark. Hopkins in the poem contrasts the beauty of nature with the ugliness of mankind's works. Hopkins was unable to consider industrialization except with overwhelming horror. He never enters into the life of industrial society and find it wishing. This weakness in Hopkins not to accept industrialism becomes apparent in The Sea and the Skylark. In these lines, the sound of the sea waves rising and falling. Poet is describing the sound of the waves, how the waves are falling and rising, and they are making sounds. The waves come and go, they rise and fall, the tides are controlled by the moon. The poet is walking by the seaside. He hears two sounds coming from the opposite directions. On ear and ear, two noises. He hears two sounds. These sounds are as old as the world itself. The sounds will never cease and will last till the world lasts. These two sounds make a deep impression on the poet's ears. From the right side comes the noise of the sea, and which at high tide strikes against the shore and rushes towards the ramp of the protective seawall. With each wave the water floods the seashore and then recedes. In this process continues. This process of sea waves striking against the seashore and then receding, striking again and receding, will continue as long as the moon continues to wave and wax, because the tides are controlled by the moon. In this stanza, poet is responding like one responds immediately to the movement of the verse as it echoes the breaking of the waves, and one admires the techniques by which it is achieved. Second part of the octave. Left hand off land I hear the lark ascend, his rash fresh rewinded new skeened score, and crisps of curl of wild winch whirl, and power and pelt music till none's to spill nor spent. In the first stanza, poet describes the two sounds He is listening from his two ears, left and right. In this stanza, he is describing what he is hearing from his left side ear and what is he hearing from his right side ear. While walking near the sea, the poet hears two sounds which make a deep impression on him, largely to stress the contrast with the frail, crumbling town. He calls them too old to end. On his right is the sea, which at high tide bounds wildly against the shore. From the right hand comes the noise of the tide, regularly striking against the shore. With each wave, the water floods and shore and then recedes with a corresponding alternation sound. This alternating noise will continue to attend upon the seashore as long as the moon continues to wax and wane. This is the first stanza he explained in this way. In these lines, left hand off land, I hear the lark ascend. In this stanza, the poet tells us about the song of the skylark from his left hand, and some distance away from the seashore comes the sound of the skylark singing as he leaves the earth and flies up into the sky. The skylark's song is ever the same. It seems to follow a musical score which may be compared to a skein of wool that is successively unwound and rewound, so that each song is as fresh as the one before. This score the skylark seems to whirl off the winch of his throat in a wild ecstasy. Ecstasy is joy, nor in a smooth or even flow, but as it were in crisp curls of melody. Every note of this melody may be compared to a lock of flea waving in the air. The skylark pours out music without effort, and yet he pelts it his fresh song continuously till he has split and spent all and there is nothing left. The skylark goes up so high and away that the music is heard no more. His fresh, rewinded, new skinned score in crisps of curl of wild winch whirl and power. In these lines contains a metaphor which is not quite clear. The difficulty arises from poet's two coinages here, fresh and new skinned. Poet himself realized the difficulty for the reader and set a long explanation on these phrases to bridges. Fresh means a headlong and exciting new snatch of singing, resumption by the lark of his song, which by turns he gives over and takes up again all day long. And the phrase new skinned, Hopkins means the skylark songs give the impression of something failing to the earth and not vertically quite, but tricklingly or wavingly, something as a skein of silk ribbed by having been tightly wound on a narrow card or a notched holder or as fishing tackle or twine unwinding from a reel or winch. In these lines, poet was quite impressed by the bird's ability to ascend in full song time after time during the day. In the above two stanzas which we have discussed, poet hears two natural sounds and the sound of the sea waves and the sound of skylark singing in the air. He feels much impressed by these sounds. Natural beauty is still a living force to him and a constant reassurance of God's concern for the world. But in the third stanza of three lines, poet's tone has changed. How these two shame this swallow and frail town, how ring right out our sordid turbid time, being pure, we life's pride and cared for crown. How these two shame this shallow and frail town. How these shame means the sea and the skylark put to shame this town with its meaningless unworthy life. Which town? The shallow and frail town? Which town? The town of Ryle, where this poem was written, is thus described: shallow and frail are terms of disparagement for the town or urban life as contrasted with the life of nature represented by the sea and the skylark. In other words, you can say modern urban life is something of which people should feel ashamed by comparison with the vigorous life of nature. How ring right out our sordid turbid time. These two pure sounds, which two pure sounds? The sea and the skylark. The sounds of sea and the music of skylarks rings out, demolishes. By contrast, our sordid, confused and ugly urban civilizations of nature in general are pure and devoid of any sin. Being pure, these two sounds of the life of natural, which are pure and sweet. We life's pride and cared for crown. We stands for human beings. So we the human beings are the pride and crown of all the creation. We are destroying the nature. We are the most cared for being. That is cared by God. We are cared by God, but we are destroying the creation of God. So in these lines, the poet contrasts the elemental purity with the shallow and frail town with its sordid, turbid look and atmosphere. Town is Ryle here. The town referred to is Ryle. This town was a summer resort to which English people thronged from May onward. The poet says that the two sounds of the sea and the skylark are putting Ryle to shame, because they are so pure and sweet. The voices emanating from nature rise far above the sordid and confused human sounds. It is so because the voices from the objects of nature are pure. The town is shallow and pale. The human sounds of the town are sordid and confused. The poet says that human beings are the pride of creation and the crown of all beings in the world. Even God cares for the human beings. Yet we, the human beings, have lost cheer and charm, the state of joy, because of the sinfulness and selfishness of our industrial civilization. In the beginning of the video, I have told you that he is not liking the industrialization or urbanization. He is in favor of nature, God's creation. We have lost the state of innocence and happiness which men enjoyed in ancient times. In this stanza, we can say that poet's sensitivity to beauty seems to be so delicate that he appears unable to consider industrialization except with the overwhelming horror. He never enters into the life of industrial society and finds it wanting. He merely stands at a distance and condemned. Have lost that cheer and charm of earth's pastime. He continues saying that the charm, the sweetness, the holiness of the earth is destroyed by the human beings who are the best creation of God. have lost that cheer and charm of earth's past prime. Our make and making break are breaking down to man's last dust, drained fast towards man's first slime. While walking near the sea, the poet hears two sounds and is describing them. The poet says that man was created last as life's crown, God's special care, but to the poet both men are species and his products seem to be crumbling back to dust. The poet says that we are gradually being reduced to the featureless materials out of which we have been made. It was out of dust that man was originally made, and to dust we shall ultimately return. We are losing our constructive energy rapidly and are moving fast to our doom, to our original state of dust. Why? Because we are going away from nature and we are rushing towards the urbanization and industrialization. And also we have lost the faith in God. The rhyme scheme of the sonnet is ABBA, ABBA, CDC, DCD. The pattern Hopkins followed is of Petrarch, the Italian poet, who has derived this form of the poetry that is known as sonnet. Thank you very much. This is all in this poem.